as a tradition, I'm going to make three prostrations to the Buddha. People who are accustomed with that and happy to do that, do so with me. Rest and then make yourself comfortable and take your seat. So, in this new program, the summer program from May to end of August, so my participation is only during this in May, and as in front of you, there are some there's a program, so my. In the program, there are four Tuesday evenings with me in this program, and four Wednesday evenings. But now there's a little bit change. Instead of four Tuesday evenings, I'm going to take three Tuesday evenings because the 21st, from 21st, it is quite difficult to me to have a class because there are some other unexpected things that happen. So therefore, we'll have three Tuesday evening class. And these three Tuesday evenings are, you know, the during those three Tuesday evenings, my talk and also our questions and answers and other activities are mainly focused on more to those people who are relatively new in teachings of the Buddha or the Buddha Dharma in terms of the more like a introduction level, not any detail in the teachings of the Buddha. And so tonight, and my talk will be mainly focused on the historical Buddha, taught to his followers, as a traditionally called path, or the means and methods that they can apply in their daily lives as a spiritual journey. So this evening my main talk will be on that topic, and the next Tuesday I want to build on that, to mainly I was going to focus on how that the path, the method, the means, are practiced by his followers. And the third Tuesday evenings will be mainly focused on more in the meditational the state, how the meditation is used or applied by his followers to enhance their spiritual journey or the spiritual path. So I'm going to focus on those three areas during these three Tuesday evenings. So the style or the manner of the class will be very much interaction rather than me to talk. That means I will not talk very long period, maybe longest 40 minutes. Then we'll have a good questions and answers or discussion. Through that, then I will try to address if there are some important points need to be explained. It is a very in a style of informal, like a form of discussion, rather than me to teach. In that way, usually more productive than my experience, if we have this kind of interaction, questions, answers, and suggestions, and so forth. Oh yeah. So the first, it is useful, helpful, whether you are already following the teachings of the Buddha, or you are not following at this stage, or even you don't want to follow the teachings of the Buddha, you come here just simply out of your curiosity. You come here, and what all this different background, different interests. What is useful and helpful, which will benefit to everybody, is to participate, to join the class with a positive mind, with a positive intention, and that is something useful, regardless of having different background and a different interest. If we join, participate with a positive intention, and that positive intention can be a very, very simple, the common sense, everyday, the positive mind intention that we all have. We all have the abilities, potentials to experience, to hold many layers of positive thoughts, minds, the emotions, and there's no doubt. Regardless of the different backgrounds, some may have some form of spirituality, some may not have, regardless of these kind of differences, we all have the ability and the potential to experience, to hold many layers of positive mind. Only a thing that we all face is that we take for granted. We don't utilize, we don't explore that potential that we all have. We just take for granted. leave it in a saying, well, I will do tomorrow or sometime in the future. And that is one of the, you know, the shortcomings also we all, you know, the, share. So therefore, what I'm doing here, I'm encouraging, suggesting, you know, to participate, to join here, you know, the, with a positive intention, and that doesn't need to be any deep philosophy, in a philosophical sort of support, doesn't need to be any spiritual reasons or religious reasons. It can be just simple day-to-day, you know, the positive mind, and that will be a very, very useful. Then of course, people who have spiritual paths to follow, like the teachings of the Buddha, you know, the, then it is good, it is useful, helpful to set your intention according to that spiritual path that you are following. Like the, you know, the people who follow the teachings of the Buddha, you know, the holding strongly and clearly, holding the mind, taking refuge in Buddha as a one's own teacher, and taking refuge in Dharma, his teachings, as a actual means, methods, to be applied, to be experienced in our daily lives, and taking refuge in Sangha, as a one's own spiritual friends, supporters, and that mind will be extremely helpful to start with that mind. People who are already following the teachings of the Buddha. Also, another very, very useful mind, you know, to be held at the beginning of the class as a, your main intention. Again, here, people who are following the teachings of the Buddha, that is the altruistic awakened mind which genuinely, sincerely concerns, cares, well-beings of all living creatures, not only one's own well-beings, of course, one's own well-being is important, but have the ability to extend, you know, that mind towards all living beings, living creatures' well-being. You know, in Sanskrit, it is called bodhicitta, which is extremely useful, helpful mind to be experienced. Hold that mind, people who are familiar with that. So I'm just, you know, suggesting to really to join, to participate this evening gathering with a positive, a constructive intention. So then we'll just read a short prayer that is in the prayer book, page 27, This is not compulsory. This is not compulsory. Only those people who would like to join with me on the page 27. And this is these four lines. We'll read in phonetic in Tibetan. If you are interested, want to know in English, there's other next page you will see the translation, or below you will see the translation. These four lines are really help us, particularly in this case, people who are already following the teachings of the Buddha that I just mentioned, those two useful, helpful mental states to be experienced, that mind taking refuge and the altruistic awakenment. And the traditionally, read these four lines. And the purpose of the reading four lines for three times is really to make sure to have in particular in this case, people who are following the teachings of the Buddha, to make sure to have these two mental states as your the main intention to join this event. So that is the tradition. We are going to follow that.
Chanjo Pado Dane Jasu Chi Dagi Chuche Tibe Sonamati Dola Penje Sanje Tropa Jo Sanje Cheda Sodi Chona Chanjo Pado Dagi Jesu Jibe Sonamdi Rola Penje Sanje Dova Shom Sanje Cheda Tsoji Chonamda Chanju Pado Dane Jansu Che Dagi Jesu Jibe Sonamji Drola Penje Sanje Dopa Shum.
Oh yeah. Thank you. Now this will follow with a short silent meditation. Short silent meditation, just about 8-9 minutes of silent meditation. So first let me say a few words, the purpose of this silent meditation. Meditation can be done for many different purposes. Here the purpose is simply to enhance or to further cultivate a calm, clear, and a focused mind. Calm, clear, and a focused mind in the sense that our minds have the qualities, mental qualities of stillness, stability. Stability, stillness in the sense that our minds have the ability to stay to the present moment, right here and now, not moving towards the past or not looking to the future, just to stay to the present moment, right here and now. You can use your natural breathing as a sort of anchor your mind, just be with your natural breathing, or just stay to the present moment, right here and now. You know, that is the meaning of stillness or stability. Your mind not wandering, not scattering into different things. You know, just stay to the present moment. And not just stay to the present moment, right here and now, but same time your mind is fully alert, fully, you know, aware of the present moment. The full attention, attention is paid. If you use your breathing as a, you know, your mind to stay to the present moment, so your mind is fully now aware of your breathing, without any form of, you know, the conceptual activities, without any form of, you know, the analysis and judgments, interpretations, free from all those mental activities, just to stay to the present moment and be fully aware of the present moment. But do that with a full, complete relaxation, without any tense, without any that kind of, you know, tense. With the full, you know, completely your mind and body are completely relaxed, yet your mind stay to the present moment. So that is the purpose of this meditation, you know, that to people who are relatively new, you know, first try to find a comfortable, right, comfortable sitting posture, wherever you are sitting, on the chair, on the cushion. Make yourself very comfortable, you know, relax, yet have some form of structure, body structure, such as your back is straight, you know, yet it is completely relaxed. You know, when we straight our back, sometimes, you know, we tend to, you know, put pressure or, you know, the tense, not in that, very relaxed, yet have some form of structure. Then gently, you know, rest your mind or focus your mind to the present moment, using your breathing or whatever you like to choose, or without any particular object, just to stay to the present moment. Through that, you know, try to experience a calm, clear, and a focused mind. So we'll do just about, you know, 8-9 minutes silent meditation. So some of you know these next three, as I mentioned earlier, the next three Tuesday evenings are my last Tuesday evening classes at this center. And so I decided to, on the part of the, having a, a level of introduction, into the teachings of the Buddha, but to do that, to read a, sutra, sutra means a teaching, a text which, attributed to the historical Buddha, as his teachings, and among many sutras, there's one particular sutra which is called Dhammapada, very sort of well sort of studied, applied the, its teachings well applied by those the follower of the Buddha, their everyday lives, the contents of that teaching, Dhammapada. And there are two versions, it's slightly different, but not very, very big difference in the Pali canon, one version, and in Sanskrit, canon, one version. So in the Tibetan, that we have Dhammapada, we call Tsong, it is coming from the Sanskrit version of Dhammapada, and the Theravadan, teachings like Sri Lanka, Burma, Thailand, they used Dhammapada, which, coming from the Pali language, based on Pali language. And I've chosen the Theravadan version, because starting from tomorrow, next three Wednesday evening, I'm reading another text, which is coming from the Tibetan great master, whom I have his writings, whom I have a great admiration, and I have studied many years, and I have shared that at this place and many other places. So the next three Wednesdays, starting from tomorrow, my the last part of my the class at this center, I'm going to focus on the Tibetan, and not the Tibetan Dhammapada, but the Tibetan Buddhist the teachings, coming from, of course, coming from the Sanskrit base, Sanskrit tradition. So I thought it this time, it is good to read the Dhammapada coming from Pali version, the Theravadan tradition, or the practitioners used it. And it is quite relatively, the big sort of text. It has some, the 300 something verses. And the Theravadan version is, this Pali version is a little bit longer than the Sanskrit version. Of course, therefore, we cannot cover, unable to cover all the verses. But as I mentioned tonight, I would like to start from the, what do we call the path. The path, that means the that historical Buddha taught to his followers, what should be utilized, what should be used, what should be applied as a spiritual journey, in their daily lives, in their everyday lives, to enhance, to enhance, to make their life more constructive, more meaningful, more useful and helpful, in a happier, more fulfilled, content, you know, and also at the same time, you know, to minimize, to reduce, and if it is possible to overcome some of those, you know, the difficulties, you know, the challenges, you know, the shortcomings, you know, the, so what kind of means and methods to be, you know, to be used, you know, to have that kind of life, life which has more, you know, the constructive, more meaning, more fulfillment, more sort of contentment, and less difficulties, less challenges, less, you know, the what you call the, you know, the greed, and so forth. And that is sort of the life that we all like to have, you know, the, and same as to his followers, you know, the, at his time, during his time, you know, the, when he starts his first teaching, after his enlightenment, you know, he taught to the taught just you know, five his, you know, the, previous friends, his first teaching, and after that he had almost 40 something years, you know, the what you call the, you know, period that he taught to his followers, and you know, although, you know, the more than 2,600 years, you know, the passed since the historical Buddha, you know, was on this planet, but still, you know, there are huge followers of his teachings. And that is what I thought it is good to, you know, what he taught to his followers at his time. And what, you know, the, although there are differences, but, you know, when it goes into more detail, when it's got into more, you know, yeah, more detail, but overall, as a follower, followers of the teachings of the Buddha, at this time, on this 21st century, you know, what are the core sort of, you know, the means and methods do they use, you know, the, as the teachings of the Buddha, do the followers, do they use, you know, what they use to, again, to fulfill, to have more meaning, to have a constructive life, you know, the, to themselves and also to the other human fellows or other living beings or their environments. And I thought that's good to, you know, good to start, you know, the, this first evening. And that's what here the term is used, path, the path. And that's what, so I'm going to read few verses from this section, and we'll have, you know, I will sort of give some comments on those, then we'll have some discussion or the questions and answers. So the verse, the chapter is called The Path, and the verse here in this edition, the verse 273, that is the Pali version of Dhammapada, and to verse 273. So text, this verse says this: the Eightfold Path is the most honorable way. The Four Noble Truths, the most honorable utterance. Freedom from craving, the most honorable state, and the all-seeing Buddha, the most honorable being. So that is this verse, verse 273. So we are mainly focusing, going to focus on first, you know, the, those four lines, saying the eightfold path is the most honorable way. So what Buddha taught to his followers, you know, to he taught his followers as a means and methods or the path here, you know, the, in their daily lives, in their everyday lives, you know, the, to apply these the eightfold path, eightfold path. So there are eight, you know, things. Most are very much related to the mental state. Of course, you know, the, can also have some verbal and physical, but you know, the main focus is on the mental state. There are eight. So before I go all eight one by one, first we'll look at in a more that the eightfold can be, you know, summarized, can be you know, explained with the three, what technically called three trainings. And the three trainings are, you know, the concentration, ethics, and wisdom. Concentration, ethics, and wisdom. You know, the concentration in the sense Buddha taught to his followers, Buddha taught to his followers many different ways, many different, by many different means, mainly to his followers, you know, to have a mental state, to have a mental state which is extremely flexible, which is extremely flexible, which is extremely, you know, capable mental state. And capable and flexible will have when our mental state, when our mind and has this kind of quality which I mentioned earlier, stillness and the clarity. When that kind of mental qualities, stillness in the sense our minds have the ability to stay with one event or one object, you know, without any wandering, without any scattering, just to stay with one event or one object. That's the meaning of stillness. And the clarity, while the mind stays with one event or one object, the mind is fully alert, mind is fully sort of, you know, aware of the whatever it is with, mind is with it. So that is the overall the meaning of concentration. Of course, concentration can be explained in many different layers, many different stages. The bottom line, the foundation is having that kind of mental state, you know, the stillness and the clarity. Stillness in the sense our minds have the ability, have the qualities, if we want to stay to the present moment, right here and now, it is able to stay. It is not distracted, it is not wandered, you know, not in that way. And that is the quality of stillness. And same time, have this clarity, the full attention is present. Fully, you know, full awareness is present, and that quality here, the concentration. When our minds have that kind of quality, that kind of, you know, the quality, then the mind will be extremely flexible. Flexible in the sense, you know, that we can sort of utilize, or we can, you know, at this stage, many of us, we do not have that much control over our mental states. our minds, more or less minds, thoughts, emotions, you know, the sort of, you know, the what you call it, like our masters, like, you know, like our master. We are like more like a slave of these our mental states, you know, that we do not have that much to say. So that if we are through the training, if we are able to enhance these two mental qualities, stillness and the clarity or concentration, you know, that then our mind will be extremely flexible. We will, you know, a sort of, you know, channel, we will lead our mental state, which direction, where and when we want to go. And that is what here, flexible. So concentration. Concentration, cultivation of concentration is not a unique, you know, the teachings of the Buddha. It is a common. It is a common teachings, and it is a common practice. It is commonly cultivated, developed in ancient Indian spiritual, you know, journeys, spiritual teachings, like Brahmin, like Jain, like, you know, many other ancient Indian spiritual traditions have the teachings, have the practices, you know, the, to cultivate concentration. It is common. And it, you know, these great teachers, like the Buddha, like the, you know, the Jain master, those, they all have, you know, they had seen having that kind of mental state is extremely useful, helpful to work with their mental state. At the present, at the moment, many of us, even if we want to enhance some other mental quality, like a strong sense of compassion, like a strong sense of love, or some other mental qualities, you know, we may experience, you know, glimpse of compassion, you know, glimpse of genuine love, but they will not last that long, or they are relatively partial, not impartial, and they are very, you know, so it is because, you know, the foundation is not you know, the foundation is not there to the like this mental state to grow. And so this is the first out of the three. The second is ethics. So now here, the ethics, of course, in the West, you know, you have a long history of, you know, advocating what is ethics, you know, the way you can, you know, the ethic and unethical, all those things. But it is in the same in the East, you know, the ethics is very important, you know, the part of the spiritual journey. And not only in the spiritual journey, you know, the ethics is very crucial as an individual's life to be, you know, constructive, to be, you know, the fruitful, meaningful, having an ethical life. And this is the second one, is the ethics, which we will look at a little bit detail when we look at the eightfold path. Then third one is wisdom. Now here, then, you know, the these, I'm talking about Indian spiritual traditions. Here then, among the Indian spiritual traditions, then there are some big differences, Buddhist and non-Buddhist. I'm not saying one is better than the other. I'm not saying one is right, others are wrong, but I'm simply saying there are differences within the, you know, ancient Indian spiritual traditions when it comes to explanation of what is wisdom. And from that difference, then we we can also talk about difference in ethics. There also we can talk about difference in the cultivation or development of concentration. You know, in general, having concentration, having ethics, having wisdom is not unique in the teachings of the Buddha. All the ancient Indian spiritual traditions have teachings and have, you know, the practices in all these three areas which are mentioned. So now, those three as a summary of the Eightfold Path. Now, out of the Eightfold Path, first, you know, there are different orders, because I start with the concentration as the first. So the out of the eight, three belongs to the concentration. And the three are called, you know, the mindfulness, concentration, and effort. Yeah, right effort. Thank you. Right effort. So the right, you know, the mindfulness, right concentration, and the right effort, or sometimes called joyous effort. Doesn't matter which way. So out of the eight, these three, you know, the right mindfulness, right, you know, the concentration, and the right effort. But these two, right, the first one, which is the mindfulness, and the third one, which is the effort, it is, you know, the part of the cultivation of the second one, which is called concentration. So in other words, those out of the eight, you know, these are the first three belongs to the concentration. Then the next three, right livelihood, right action, and right speech. So these three belongs to the second training, which is called ethics. Right, you know, the livelihood, right action, and the right speech, which I will come a little bit detailed explanation. Now remain only two, right thought and right view. So those are the two belongs to the wisdom, right thought and right view. Right view. So those are the eightfold path. So Buddha, the historical Buddha, taught to his followers, you know, to apply these eightfold paths in their everyday lives. From the morning, you know, even, you know, when you go to bed, all the time to apply these eightfold paths. You know, the right mindfulness, which is extremely important, helpful, useful. If we are mindful what we say, what we do, what we, you know, all those things, then, you know, relatively, you know, easily we'll avoid those, you know, unhelpful, you know, unhealthy activities, you know, because as a human beings, majority, 99%, you know, don't want to harm others. You know, even though, for example, these days, you know, we hear lots of, you know, the unpleasantness. But if you look at in the percentage, the people who, you know, inflict that kind of pain and difficulties to the other human beings, very, very small percentage. Although we keep hearing it all the time. know, so that shows, you know, naturally, the majority of the human beings really don't want to inflict or don't want to cause pain and difficulties to others. But, you know, due to a lack of mindfulness, in the sense not being mindful what we say, what we do, how we do, and so on and so forth, and also not be mindful, you know, the, what's happening to the others and they, you know, the environments and so on and so forth, then, you know, the, we enter into, you know, the some unfortunate things and events. And mindfulness is very, very useful tool, mental tool, to give us, you know, to live this life more constructively, more meaningfully, more joyfully, you know, mindfulness. And concentration, if we have a you know, the mental state to concentrate, to focus on, then we are able to do, in this case, if you like to have a spiritual path, that spiritual path can be very, what you call the productive, because there's a focus, there's a concentration, you know, the mind is not wandering, you know, past to the present, present to the future, back and forth, and like a yo-yo, you know, and that more time, lots of the time, just not very much meaning, not very much purpose, just wandering, just, you know, like that. So the having concentration is very, very useful. And the effort, right effort, you know, the effort, of course, you know, the majority of us work very hard, but, you know, we can say, you know, I put lots of effort, this and that, but our effort is, you know, focused on not necessarily in a long-term benefits or meaningful things and events, you know. So here, the effort should, you know, of course, you know, here effort is mainly referring to something meaningful, useful, and long-term beneficial, and that's living that kind of life, you know, that is the first three, you know, the eightfold path. Then the next three, relation to the ethics, right livelihood. Again, extremely useful to ourselves, to others, next generations, generation after, you know, if we live our life, here the right livelihood in the sense what we need, of course we need food, shelter, medicines, friendships, these are the basic necessities. Without these, we will not survive that long. But, you know, how to get these things, and not just how to get these things, how to use these things, you know, that is very, very important. You know, Buddha, the historical Buddha, said to his first five followers, he said, you know, to have a middle way lifestyles. What does that mean, middle way lifestyle? It means what he said, you know, should not indulge in sense pleasures. He didn't say don't have sense pleasures, but should not indulge in sense pleasures. And that is Buddha thought extreme. And on the other hand, what Buddha said, not to neglect your basic necessities. If you neglect basic necessities, that will damage your life. If you indulge in the sensory pleasures, you know, that will not going to be very, very, you know, the fulfilling life. It is like a bottomless, you know, the container. In a bottomless container, no matter how much we pour, never going to be complete full, because there's no bottom. You know? So if we all the time try to chase sensory pleasure, you know, then there's no genuine satisfactory. You know? So that's what Buddha said. Have a middle level. Lifestyle, middle level. And this is what here important. Right livelihood. Now pay attention. Be mindful. Now that our needs, how they are gained, how they are used. Now, and that is important. You know, how we get those our needs as much as we can, you know, causing harm to others' lives, others, you know, the livelihood, others' environment. How to use them when we gain? Again, use them as less as possible to harm others' life, others' environment, others' livelihood. And that is here, right livelihood. Very, very useful, particularly the 21st century. You know, what we talk about, globalize. We want global things, want to consume. You know, and what we eat, what we wear, what we have is not just local. And the impact is not just the local, impact is global. And it is not just our generation. The impact will last for many, many generations. So that is important. Right livelihood. Right action. The particular in this case, the physical activities. You know, of course, you know, in the Buddhist, you know, way, we talk about, you know, do, cha, nyao, do, walking, eating and drinking, and do, cha, nyao, sleeping and sitting. Those are the just five, you know, basically our body, you know, do that. And those things, when we engage in those activities should not, you know, at least intentionally not cause harm to others. Minimum, intentionally not cause harm for others. You know, this is not a matter of, you know, the future lives or anything like that in this lifetime. You know, intentionally causing harm to others will not have, you know, the person will not, you know, the genuinely, sincerely experience or have a deep down joy or happiness. Even though physically surface, you know, may see some kind of, you know, the things, but deep down, never. So this, you know, the right action. Really pay attention, be mindful, you know, in those physical activities, and try to, you know, pay attention not to cause harm, at please, you know, intentionally, and that is right action and right speech. Very, very important, you know, the speech that we have, the language that we have, is unique in certain extents among the millions of different species on this planet. You know, the human beings have the most elaborated, most sort of sophisticated language to communicate with other fellows. In a certain extent, maybe even the animals. You know, the place where I live in Stratton, the Stratton Common, when I go for a walk, there are many dog walkers, and you know, people who take their dogs or other people's dogs. And if they are, you know, in the group, sometimes they talk to each other, but individual constantly talking to their dogs. And sometimes I wonder how much the dog understand his conversation. But anyway, the point of what I'm making is this: we have this speech. It is very, very useful, helpful, if we use it properly, correctly, rightly. We can learn from others, we can communicate to others, we can share our experience to others, we can understand others, you know, what feelings, thoughts, emotions, through language. But it is also, if it is not used properly, correctly, rightly, very, very destructive. You know, one word may cause huge pain to somebody, even to a certain extent, physically harming, more painful than the physical harm. You know. So therefore, right speech, paying attention, and you know, to what to say, how to say, where to say, when to say, is useful. You know. So the right speech, and these are related to the second. Again, this is not really very much talking about next life, enlightenment, liberation. It is talking about this lifetime's well-beings of ourselves, our families, colleagues, communities, and societies. We all know, you know, that. So this is very, very helpful. So that the Buddha taught his followers to have these, to live their life with these kind of principles. You know, right livelihood, right action, right speech, relation to the ethics. Then the last two, right thought and right view. Now, in this case, what I'm going to do, I'm going to read another verse which have you know, two verses which I'm going to read, which is quite useful. And the reading is verse 200, same chapter, verse 277 and 78 and 79, these three verses in relation to, I will not go one by one, those two, right thought and right view as a together. So, verse 277, all conditioned things are impermanent. When you see this, with insight, you will tire of this life of suffering. And this is the way of purification. So here's all conditioned things. Conditioned things referring to that things and events, you know, when I say things and events, I'm talking about all the here around what we have, the things and events, you know, they're coming into being, they're coming into existence, is dependent on the causes and conditions. You know, this is the little bit philosophical side. All things and events, you know, their coming to being, coming into existence, is dependent on causes and conditions, are called conditioned things. Conditioned things. And here, what Buddha says to his follower, you know, all those things, conditioned things, are impermanent. Are impermanent. And when you see, when we see this with insight, you know, that seeing this, understanding this nature, the nature of impermanence, you know, impermanence in the sense momentariness. The all things and events within us, around us, including ourselves, are impermanent, not static, not permanent. They are constantly in a stage of changing, momentariness in the Buddhist term. Moment by moment, even the shortest moment of time, they don't stay static. There's no moment these things stay static. No matter whatever shortest time that, you know, we talk about, even that shortest time, they are moving, changing. And Buddha, the historical Buddha, you know, sees, understood, understanding that nature, the nature of impermanence, is something very, very crucial, you know, the understanding. If you have that understanding that here, this body, this mind, this individual, these possessions, surrounding, they all are impermanent, going to change, and changing every moment, changing. When I say changing, it doesn't mean table become books, books become flowers. Not in that sense, momentariness. And that is one of the right views. And to have that kind of thought. Things are impermanent, not static. So that's what Buddha says, you know, when you see this, with insight, that nature of the things and events, you know, the impermanence, then, you know, that is the purification. What does that mean, that's purification? When that understanding, when that realization, when that insight is really cultivated or nurtured within ourselves, within our mental state, many of our unhealthy mental state will disappear. Like greed, particularly, craving, clinging, grasping, attachment. All these mental states, you know, greed, attachment, craving, they all, you know, will slowly disappear if we manage to cultivate this insight. If we look at, you know, the greed, the craving, the grasping, they all arise believing there's a something I can hold on. So that's why Buddha means this is the way to purification. Buddha said in the same text somewhere there, Buddha said to his followers, I cannot, you know, purify your difficulties, your challenges, pouring water upon you. I cannot wash your challenges, your sufferings, pouring water upon you. Even though I have compassion, but I can't do that. I cannot take away by my hands your difficulties. What I can do, he said, I can show the way, the path, like this purification. And that's really important, what Buddha said. Okay, well, Thomas, now. Mm-hmm. Now, next verse 278, Buddha said this. All conditioned things are inherently lacking. When we see this with insight, we will be tired of this life of suffering. This is the way to purification. So this, the next one, saying that all conditioned things are inherently lacking. This is very profound meaning. And this is the what, you know, the many, and also next verse, many contemporary Buddhist, you know, the historical Buddhist, contemporary spiritual teachers had disagreement with the Buddha. This one and the next verse, I'll read these two as ones. Next verse is this. All realities are devoid of an abiding self. All realities are devoid, empty or devoid of an abiding self. When you see this this with insight, we will tired of life of suffering. This is the way to purification. So the Buddha, you know, at the Buddha's time, there were many great other spiritual teachers. Buddha had lots of interactions with them, you know, the contemporary great teachers, like, you know, the founder of the Jainism and many others. But one of the big difference, Buddha's view and his contemporary, those great teachers' view, relation to, you know, first relation to the, what is here as a I or self or individual, and what is there as a table or as a body, as a feeling. Buddha, the historical Buddha view, he understood in this mind and body, which is, you know, constantly changing, you know, constantly moving. In this, you know, the Buddhist term aggregate, you know, skanda, in this mind and body, on this mind and body, there isn't a self. There isn't a soul, if you use the, you know, the Abrahamic religious tradition, or, you know, term soul or self, and in ancient Indian tradition, atma. There isn't a self. There isn't an I or atma or soul, something static, eternal. You know, there isn't. It is for Buddha that is impossible. On the basis of mind and body, which are constantly fluctuating, changing, moving, and so on and so forth, in that there's some kind of eternal self, or the soul, or the individual. That's impossible. And that's what the Buddha said. There's no that kind of... He didn't say there's no self. He didn't say there's no, you know, Atma. What he said, there's no eternal, there's no static self or soul within this changing mind and body. And that's what this, you know, the verse 279 saying, all realities are devoid of an abiding self. abiding self in the sense static, eternal, that kind of entity. And that understanding, wisdom, is very, very different from many of his Buddha's contemporary Indian spiritual traditions, because many of Indian spiritual traditions, there are two or three small groups or schools which are not Buddhist but still not assert that kind of self, but majority, similar to the Abrahamic religious tradition, you know, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, but Buddha has a very, very different understanding in that context. So that is the wisdom which here, where the right thought, the view. So, and that is important, you know, for the follower of the teachings of the Buddha. You know, the ethics and the concentration, which we talked about earlier, the previous, out of the eight folds, previous six, are very much based on, you know, the practitioner's entire engaging into living in that kind of lifestyle is very much shaped, very much supported by the wisdoms. The last two noble truths, the last two eightfold paths, right thought and right view. And what we have so far here, right view, right thought, I've just mentioned two. I'm going to edit another one, which is next verse. The first one is view, see, understand, all conditioned things are impermanent. And if individuals, his or her mind has that kind of view, his own here, mind and body and life, and his or her possessions, and his environment, all these things are in that nature of impermanent. His or her dealing with those things will be very, very different, as I mentioned earlier. Less craving, less greeting, less all those things. And the same, the second one, you know, from the Buddhist point of view, you know, the viewing, seeing, there's no such as eternal, some kind of, you know, unchanging soul or the I or the self in here. The I or the self or the soul is very much, you know, the part of what is here as a mind and body, and the fluctuation of changing and coming and going, there isn't some kind of eternal, some kind of permanent, eternal I of the individual. That gives a very, very useful outlook as an individual. Individual is constantly evolving, constantly changing, not static. In that way, you know, very, very useful. So then the last one, which I will leave here, is already 8:30. I said we'll have a good discussion, but now I'm talking all the whole hour. So the last one is, you know, to have an understanding that things and events within us and around us, you know, within us and around us, no matter how they are beautiful, no matter how they are good, no matter how they are attractive, no matter how they are valuable, or on the other side, all, you know, the opposite of that, you know, all these things and events, they have a potential. They have a potential to bring unhappiness. They have a potential to bring unhappiness. It is our how to handle them. You know, if we handle them properly, correctly, rightly, with those Noble Eightfold Path, this will become very, very helpful, useful. If we handle them without these, like a mindfulness, like a concentration, like an ethics, like a wisdom, they may cause us pain and difficulties. And that is the third relation to the last two, right thought and the right view. So that is it. So I want to take at least a few questions. It is very useful. I should talk less to give more time for questions. But I want to take a few questions, even though it's already 8:30.
Okay.
There's a microphone.
Sorry. When you come to this no I, no soul, how does that fit in with reincarnation? And when you, obviously in Tibetan, they believe in hungry ghosts and things like that.
Who said that?
I've read your book.
I didn't say that.
So how does that fit in? How do you see spirits and things like that? How do you explain that phenomenon?
Okay. If you believe or if you think, you know, that living beings or living creatures is the only those creatures visible to our eyes, then you have I will agree with what you're saying. But living beings, there are many, many, many living beings, that we cannot see. This is nowadays is quite clear. There are many living beings beyond our what's called seeing and touching and hearing. So when you use these terms, a little bit alien, like you use hungry ghost, it depends on which way you interpret.
We don't get much food.
Even though in this kind of developed country, there are lots of hungry ghosts. If you go to supermarket, you will see trolleys are full. That's a sign of hungry ghosts. Sorry, I'm not. I don't want to. So anyway, answer to question to your. First part of the question is quite interesting one. So the concept of the liberation, concept of rebirth, is yes. It seems if there isn't any kind of static person, static arm, how it's possible to have the next line. It sounds quite a feasible question, but actually, if you talk about the River Thames, maybe how many thousands of years flowing, you say? Yeah.
Yeah, right.
If you look at one by one, there isn't any some kind of permanent, static, eternal River Thames. The riverbed is constantly changing. The water molecules are constantly moving. So to have some kind of continuation, you don't have to have some kind of static, unchanging nature. Is that okay, what I'm saying?
Hmm.
Good. Any other question? Yeah. Yes.
I
passion.
Yeah, like a lot of energy to know what they really want to do in life, even so it changes, you know, that's a problem. But according to Buddhism, it's always said like passion in general isn't good.
Oh, that is wrong interpretation.
Okay, good. That's kind of
passion should not be, you know, if you say passion only in the sense of greed, then I agree. You know, Buddha constantly said to his followers not to have greed. But it, you know, the Buddha is extremely passionate, you know, to teach his, you know, his teachings to his followers. His followers at Buddha's time were passionate to practice mindfulness. So that it depends on how you interpret the meaning of that passion. I would put it, passion maybe similar to effort, joyous effort. There's a joy. Same time you're doing it, even though it's tough, hard. Like my usual example, is, you know, those people who have a very risky, expensive hobby. And even though their fingernails are completely ruined, try to climb on the rock, but they have a passion. Is it? So it depends on how you interpret the meaning of, you know, that word passion. Buddha didn't say don't enjoy your life. What Buddha says, don't have less greed. That's what Buddha said. Okay?
Yes.
One more question. Yeah, can you pass down the pen?
Thank you, Geshe. I would like to, Geshe gave a little bit of explanation about the attachment and greedy. I wish I could. It's known that the greed is not okay. But how can we, example, contribute to someone's awareness in order to make understand that the greed is not the best option sometimes?
Okay. I'll start first in before you to share to others. Greed is not good. First, apply it upon oneself. Greed is not helpful, useful method to make life more comfortable, more content, you know. If we apply that to one's own life, then to share with others is quite straightforward. Many of us, including myself, you know, we don't apply those things to ourselves, then try to impose upon others. Then we face challenge, difficulties. If we apply those greedy is not good, not useful, when you apply that principle to one's own life, then to share with others is not difficult. Even people can learn from one's own lifestyles, one's own way of life. We don't need to say to others, oh, don't be too greedy. We don't need to say that. If we just apply that in our own lifestyle, people will see that. Our children will learn from that. You know, the best thing if we want to, you know, share our whatever positive principles that we have, share with our close people, those people who are around us. We have constantly connection instead of going try to go in long distance. Okay? Yeah. Okay. We'll stop here now. It's 20 to 9. Mm? So the conclusion is dedication. And we start with the positive intention, to join the class. And now we'll end this evening class with the, in the Buddhist way, is called dedication. That is, once again, to think, to remind ourselves, coming here, participating in the class, sitting, listening, contemplating, and so forth. And these activities are something positive, constructive, and all those positive and constructive things that we have done to dedicate for the well-being of not just oneself, it is also important for the well-being of many, many other living creatures. So that is the dedication. And the traditionally we say a few verses, and people who love to join with me, prayer book, last page, there are three verses that I'm going to say. And you can join, if you want to join, join with me. Reading the verses is not important. What is important is, once again, to have this strong, positive mind which want to share all the positive things that we have done here, share with others, and that is here the meaning of dedication. Oh, yeah.
Chanju Senjo Rinpoche Maje Pana Je Yurche Je Pa Nyamba Me Paya Kone Ko. Chosen.